Let's stand up. Can you stand up for a minute? Hey, by the way, that worship team, weren't they spectacular? Where I came from, when you do something that good, you throw a shoe at them. That's what you do. You just throw a shoe at them. But anyways, we're not going to do that. Hey, I want to say this. As a lead pastor, tonight we have children's pastors that are here and directors. And I just want to say this, and I'm not using any kind of title for hierarchy or anything. I just want to say this. Some of the greatest champions that I know in the church today are right here in this room. No, you didn't hear me. Some of the greatest champions are in this room. My wife has been a children's pastor and director, and I could tell you the countless lives that get touched, the countless lives, and I'm one of them because I'm a PK, I'm a pagan's kid. And so what happened is when I was a young man, my first exposure to the gospel was a lady who did sidewalk Sunday schools in our neighborhood in Mountain View, California. And I was a little guy, and my parents would say, well, you can go spend time with her. And that was my first exposure to who Jesus Christ was. So what you do is huge and big. And before we get started, turn around, high five a few people and say, did you hear them? You're something special. Go ahead. That's awesome. We got to work on some of your rhythm because I actually saw some of you miss hands when you were trying to high five. I know we're in the Northwest, but come on, we could do better than that. Hey, listen, it is an honor and a privilege. I've been asked to talk about connecting with how God made you. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I've been married 33 years, going to be 34 years in February. Been in ministry for 35 years, have five sons. One by adoption, four biologically. I've been 30 years of football coach at high school level. So one of our sons was in the foster system. I was coaching in an at-risk school. He became part of our family, and his name is David. And my other sons are great. We never had a dull moment in our house. So now I'm an empty nester, and man, I'll tell you, it is something else getting used to it. It's too quiet for me. But I am a grandpa. And so I have a grandson who's 6 years old, going on 27, and he's a great kid. So he keeps me honest. And you know what? I grew up in a home that was the functional definition of dysfunction. Four generations. I'm Puerto Rican Italian, by the way. Yeah. My Italian side wants to feed you. My Puerto Rican side wants your wallet. But anyways, boy, I just got myself in trouble with some stereotypes there, huh? But four generations of alcoholism on both sides of my family. I'm the first generation that's sober because of what Jesus Christ has done. You, listen, the first generation. If you would have asked me that I would be able to do and was called to do what I'm doing, I'd have told you you're crazy. Because as a young man, this wasn't even on my radar. But through a process of God doing so many different things, because I grew up in a home that we thought 151 was a scripture verse. You know what I mean? My grandmother used to have Gallo wine in the house. And I said, Mom, Grandma, why do we always have this big bottle of Gallo wine? She said, because Jesus is a Galilean. I believed it. I said, oh, that makes sense. Okay, that's... I grew up in a home that had physical violence. Thank God that my dad came to Christ 30 days before he passed on from an aneurysm of the brain. He was a football coach. And I'll tell a little bit of that story. But to be here is a miracle for me. And tonight we're going to talk about identity. But we're going to talk about stuff. Because in all the years of ministry, I still hear the same thing from people. And probably you're the same person that's in this room. And here's what goes through people's heads. They be serving in ministry, they're going to church, they love Jesus, but I'm still unworthy. I'm not good enough. God, how could you use me? And there may be some of us in our room that we're battling our private dragons. Nobody knows about them. Our own brokenness. And what I want to talk about today is God uses people who has stuff. And that God is in the business of getting us back because, see, we're going to find out the importance of identity. Leadership and influence doesn't begin with organic skills. It begins with us knowing who we are and functioning out of how God's created us to be. And when that is brought into wholeness, then we can be the best tool in the master's hand. Let me kind of give you a list of what comparative religions do with stuff. You want to hear it? This is some good stuff. Listen to this. Taoism, stuff happens. Confucianism, Confucius say stuff happens. Buddhism, if stuff happens, it isn't really stuff. Hinduism, this stuff has happened before. Islam, if stuff happens, it is the will of Allah. Catholicism, if stuff happens, you deserve it. Protestantism, let stuff happen to someone else. That's funny. Lutheran, if stuff happens, don't talk about it. Fundamentalism, if stuff happens, you will go to hell unless you're born again. Amen. Judaism, why does this stuff always happen to us? Calvinism, stuff happens because you don't work. Seventh-day Adventism, no stuff shall happen on Saturday. Christian Science, stuff happens, but it's all in your mind. Jehovah Witnesses, knock, knock, stuff happens. Evangelical Christians, if you work harder, stuff will not happen. Baptist, stuff can only happen when we vote on it. And then Rastafarianism, let's smoke this stuff. We've all got stuff. We've all got stuff. We're all broken people. And here's the thing. The thing is, God uses people that are broken. God uses us in spite of us. God takes who we are, and he begins to utilize the best of who we are, even in spite of us being broken. So tonight we're going to talk a little bit from the life of an individual by the name of Mephibosheth, and we're going to use that as a starting point. If you have a Bible, turn with me. We're going to turn to 2 Samuel 4:4. 2 Samuel 4:4. And we're going to talk a little bit about Mephibosheth and talk about this guy. Now, let me kind of set the stage for you. Here's what happens. David enters into this love relationship with his buddy Jonathan. And what happens is Jonathan and him become not only close friends, but at one part they literally enter into a friendship covenant. And then one day Jonathan comes to David and says, David, listen. You've been a great friend, but here's what's happening. I'm going to die. You know that my father has disobeyed God. He's rebelled against God, and he's going. And I'm going to die with him. And here's what I'm asking: just take care of my family. Just take care of my family. And the backdrop of 2 Samuel 4:4 is this. The backdrop is that we're given the story of this young man that's born. And he's born, and what happens is, boy, I don't know what happened here. My pages of my Bible are all sticking together. Have you ever had that happen on you? It's a lot of fun. This is the reason why you don't eat any kind of candy around your Bible. It's bad. Gets on your fingers, and then it sticks on the pages. And then your wife finds you, and she said, did you eat those peanut M&Ms? Yeah, I didn't eat them. Why, they're in your Bible. There's a fingerprint. So here's the backdrop of the story. Look what it says. Saul's son in verse 4. Jonathan had a son who was crippled in his feet, and he was 5 years old. And when the news about Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel, his nurse picked him up, and he fled. And in her haste to flee, it happened that he fell and became lame. And his name was Mephibosheth. I want you to catch that. They're thinking he's dead. He's died. And what happens is, They flee the scene because the Oriental tradition is whenever a ruler died, the whole family had to be killed because you didn't want an uprising. That was the Oriental tradition. So she's picking up Mephibosheth, drops Mephibosheth, and on the way out, he gets busted up. You know, there's a lot of us here tonight, we're going to talk a little bit about this, that we didn't ask for it, but we got dropped. Somewhere in our life, we got dropped. Could have been a mother, could have been a father, could have been someone in the family system. But somewhere we got dropped. See, Mephibosheth was that. We didn't ask for it. Something broke. And then all of a sudden, that broken thing becomes our identity. So you have to understand, in the Oriental tradition, to be handicapped and to be a male was a bummer. It was a bummer. It was a bad thing. You couldn't serve in the military. You couldn't fight for the nation. You were considered unproductive. And here's Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth is broken and wounded, and he's dropped. He wasn't asked for it, but he was dropped. When our story engages the story of Jesus Christ, some things begin to happen. See, this whole thing of the good news in church, because I don't know if you figured it out. After 35 years of pastoral ministry, I figured two things out about the church. People are weird, and I'm the strangest of all of them. And if you haven't come to that conclusion, you just haven't been around. This whole thing is strange. The church is a bug light. Have you ever noticed that? You know what bug light does? It attracts insects, bugs. On a Sunday morning, you got some goofy people that show up at church. Man, you just got goofy people. And then what's even weirder to me is that they even show up on a Sunday and get out of bed to show up to a thing called service. And then we gather all the goofy people in a thing called a church service. To me, I think it was a strategy by God to say, get them off the streets. We know where they're at on at least one morning out of the week. And you put them all, and then Jesus says stuff like this, and I don't quite understand this. Greater things are all you goofy people are going to do than I ever did. I didn't write that, he did. And here's the point that I'm going with this. There is something of the story of God in this thing called community in the church that when we settle in this place and we begin to understand what it really means, it's about a lovesick father who uses people, who graduates people in a way that they never dreamed that they would ever be on the journey. They would never dream that they'd be here. But we have to understand that many times we define ourselves in light of our family of origin. You know what I found out? I found out that oftentimes, the greatest thing that shapes our identity or our perception of our identity is the family system we came from. And I'm going to give you kind of a brief overview because there's three types of family systems that people come from, and you're going to see it on the screen. Here's the first one, a closed system. Some of us have come from a closed system. Let me tell you what a closed system is. A lot of addictive family systems are a closed system. And if we had a song that would identify a closed system, because see, in a closed system, you don't talk about feelings. Usually there are addictions that are in the family system. And a song that would identify, it's an old song called Silence is Golden. No one talks about anything. You never share your feelings. There's no talking. You don't trust. You don't think. You don't feel. There's a lot. What happens is there's generational consequences to it. There's depression, anger, rebellion, and rigidity. A lot of baby boomers, my generation, they came out of closed systems. And you know what they did? We made the biggest mistake. We said, we'll never be like our parents. But you know what? We reproduced everything they did with a vengeance. Because we didn't learn that you have to replace whatever you're going to change with something different, or you'll just become the very thing that you came out of. That's a closed system. Some of us came out of a mesh systems. And in a mesh system, it's codependence. And the song that identifies this is Killing Me Softly with Your Love. Because in a mesh system, everyone's got this goofy little smile. They're just so nice. They're so nice as they talk about you, and they just kind of take the knife, and they just kind of... But they'll never confront you to your face. And in a mesh system, no one really is respected individually because it's just all smothering. See, you only talk about things when everyone agrees with it. And there's kind of this us versus them and this self-righteousness that comes in. And you know what happens? People who come out of a mesh system are resentful and become hyper-judgmental. Then there's the detached system. Oh, this is a fun one. In a detached system, the song that would identify it is that old Four Tops song. How many of you remember the Four Tops? Well, one person. Thank you. The Four Tops used to sing this song, "I Can't Get Next to You." Remember that song? So one person does. Yeah, I do. And you know what it is? In this kind of a detached system, there's people are independent. They live in the same house, but they don't have relationship. They have abandonment issues. And what happens, there's a lot of anxiety and fear and immaturity. And what people kind of look at these people and they say they're socially awkward. They just don't seem to fit anywhere. Now, here's the thing. I want you to catch this. For many of us, we came out of a blend of several of those systems. Some of us, it's a closed and a mesh system all at the same time. Some of us, it might be we came out of a very detached kind of system, but it was closed. And this is what we grew up with. And so we feel stuck because then what we do is we go, man, pain's a bad thing. So I don't want to deal with my pain. So, you know, we come to church and we smile to one another. How you doing today? You know, the old preachers say, I'm doing fine today. No, you're not. We lie to each other. We're dishonest. Why? Because, man, I don't want anyone to know that I'm hurting. Pain becomes the enemy. We do everything. And you know what happens? We develop coping mechanisms then. And here's the challenge of coping mechanisms. Coping mechanisms oftentimes are unhealthy ways that we meet legitimate needs. For some of us, it might be eating too much. Or maybe sometimes we drink and nobody knows that we're drinking. For some of us, it might be that we just have depression that overtakes us, but we don't want to tell anyone that we're depressed. And these, see, the problem with coping mechanisms is we can't develop enough coping mechanisms that our adversary hasn't already made something to assault that coping mechanism. We can't invent enough. And so then we do that. And what happens? What happens is we become Christians, but we don't understand what real joy is all about. We don't understand. Listen, right now, the current context, I just had this conversation with Pastor Brent yesterday, and we were talking about this. We got so many issues that we're facing, and here's the truth of the matter. Some of the issues that the church is trying to address, we can't legitimately address, and let me tell you why. Judgment is not the only thing in the household of God that needs to begin. Honesty needs to begin in the household of God. So how in the world can we talk about what are we going to do with people who are fighting gender issues, people who are struggling with sexual issues such as homosexuality, lesbian, or transgender kind of issues when we ourselves don't even really talk about the real issues related to what it means to be created in the image of God? We don't want to talk about any of that stuff. It's taboo. Let's not talk about it because you know what? God just created this thing over here and then he says, don't talk about it. Just don't talk. And then we got children's pastors and when kids say, where did I come from? Oh, you just popped up. Jesus just blinked his eye and you just came to be. Because we don't talk about stuff. And here's the truth of the matter. Whether it's our sexuality, whether it's leadership, whether it's relationship, God created us in his image before we were married, before we were single, before we were anything. We were created in his image, and there is a stewardship and a gift that God has given us as a direct result of being in his image. And here's the other part of the story. The other part of the story, there's an adversary and a fallenness in our world that does everything it can to distort that identity. And the reason why it's so important that we get this straight is for this reason. Is you are in the most wonderful position to impact the lives of future generations. And if our identity is not intact, we will do what generations have done before us, forgetting that we teach what we know, but we reproduce who we are. We teach what we know, but we reproduce who we are. So Christ is calling us to have an identity. You know, when I was 27 years old, we had started our church, and you talk about children's ministry, and you talk about, I was a very, I had more ambition than wisdom when it came to being a young pastor. I just wanted to grow a big church. My ego was set. I wanted people to know Al Soto. I had a lot of ambition. And my wife used to tell me, you know what, honey, it's not about perfection and it's not about you. Really? I thought I saw my name in the Bible. And the truth of the matter is a lot of people in their 20s and everything, that's where we are. We have this real great ambition, and the ambition itself is not wrong. It's how we steward it. Well, anyways, on one Sunday, we just had our first son, and we're meeting in a community center. And I'm preaching a message, and there's about 150 people in the community center. And all of a sudden, my youngest son comes out of the nursery, goes over the thing, and he got out somehow, and he's walking down the center aisle, and I'm in the middle of my message, and he's got his diaper right in his hand. And right out loud, he goes, "Daddy, caca!" And I'm sitting there going, I must ignore this. My son is certainly not down the center aisle in the middle of the service holding his dirty diaper, yelling at the top of his lungs. And then he goes, "Daddy." And he repeats it. And then he runs up to me and he says, "I love you, Daddy." And he is naked and it's bad and it smells. And he runs up to me and he's holding my leg. And I'm getting a little bit irritated at first, going, "This is church, and your dad's got a job to do. Don't you understand this, my 2-year-old son?" And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, "I just gave you a moment that you can do the most significant thing, be a dad. Be a dad." And I picked up my son. I think I made it funny and said, my son is quoting the Greek word kakos, which means death. And some weird thing like that. But I learned something in that moment when God said, "You know what, Al? You struggled most of your adolescence not having a father. And I taught you that I'm a father to the fatherless. And I gave you men in your life that be a father. This is your moment to break a cycle in your life and be a dad." And as a lead pastor and as our church grew, I always had a rule of thumb that my kids were first. And I can remember one season, my second son was struggling a little bit, Michael. And he would say this to me. He says, "Dad, when you're up on," because I'd have to get up on the platform and get ready to come up. He says, "Can I just stand there with you, Dad, and hold your hand?" And I can remember just standing there, my son just holding my hand. You know, the memories that they remember are those things. He is a father of the fatherless, and he places the lonely into families. And here's what I want to talk to you. I'm going to give you several quick things here. Our destination defines our destiny. And we've been created to live in the glory of God. But first and foremost, what we need to do is we need to understand what our purpose is and what God has called us to be. And in doing so, understand that the journey is not a sprint, but that every day he's being able to exchange. He's making a daily exchange in our lives. Do you know what the word glory literally means? It doesn't mean simply what happens in a worship service, which was powerful. There was the glory of God here. But you might want to write this down. The word glory means to stand in the opinion of God. That's what it means in its core Hebrew understanding. That God, when God says, I have made you for my glory, it means that I have made you to stand in my opinion. Not the opinion of the committee that's in your head. Not the opinion of what culture or society or your history may say. But I have created you. I've created you for my glory. And God's opinion is powerful. You know, in Isaiah 55, 8 through 9, he says this, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. You know what that means? It means we're on a journey of exchanging. It's constantly import-export. God is constantly taking things in us. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, this goes on for the rest of your life. This side of heaven, we will never arrive. In our identity, God, who's the master artist, is constantly shaping us. And in shaping us, what is he doing? He's constantly taking things from our life, and he's importing and exporting. Here's the second thing. Is Imago Dei liberates us to be his masterpiece. And this is where I'm wanting to go. Ephesians 2:10 says this, for we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Do you know what the literal transliteration of that means? Listen to this. We are engineered by his design. He molded and manufactured us in Christ. We are his workmanship, his poetry. His poetry. You know what that word means? That word workmanship means a poem or a work of art that's never been created before. And we are fully fit to do good, equipped to give attractive evidence of his likeness in everything that we do. We are God's masterpiece. We are his masterpiece. Why? We've been created before time for God to do only what God can do. Now, what's the power of that? The power is this. The master artist shapes us and refines us in a way on the journey that we begin to find out that our identity is what he says my identity is. That I'm a work of art. Well, wait a second, Al. Wait a second. But I'm a flawed work of art. Yeah? Yeah? But in the midst of the flaws, the master artist takes his hands and he shapes and he develops us in such a way that he forms us and says, I have created you in my image. There's power in that. There's grace in that. I don't know how many of you ever drove Highway 5 in California. How many of you ever been down Highway 5? I had a dad that when he drove to, he had a Malibu 65 Chevelle. And he would just, I remember as a kid, he just wanted to get to Disneyland. He would not stop. We suffered. There's a place on the way to Disneyland as you go Highway 5. It's called Kettleman City. Anyone know Kettleman City? Here's the power of Kettleman City. You will know Kettleman City because you will smell Kettleman City before you ever get to Kettleman City, because all there is cattle, and cattle don't smell good. I have yet to find someone, maybe Brent, Pastor Brent might be this way, he might be one of the guys, that would say, man, I really want to get to Kettleman City. No, you don't. You don't even want to stop and eat at the Carl's Jr. there. Because you can't taste your food, you can only smell cows. I've never had anybody go, I want to camp out in Kettleman City. Hey kids, let's go watch the cows in Kettleman City. We don't need to go to Disneyland. I have yet to see that. Why? Because that's not the destination. But you can get stuck in Kettleman City. I've been stuck in Kettleman City. I had to stay in Kettleman City for for a whole day. Why? Because I had a problem with my car. My wife said, honey, the idiot light is on. I said, there's nothing wrong with it, baby. I checked the car, everything's fine. The idiot light is flashing. You need to stop. No, we're okay. Bad. Guess where I ended up? A garage in Kettleman City. See, some of us on our journey, because of fear or anything else, we're stuck. And part of the reason why we're stuck is there are three things that are going to define who we are: our view of God, a view of ourselves, and a view of others. And if we get stuck in any part of those three, and I hear people go, well, I'm just broken. That's just who I am. You just don't understand. I've got issues. And if we focus and create and make the issues of our life our identity, we will stay stuck. Versus seeing the power of grace, in which we are already loved in spite of our stuff, and that God can still use us regardless of stuff. You didn't hear me. I'm going to tell you right now, that's some good preaching. Do you follow what I'm saying? There is not a pastor with any kind of integrity who has his life submitted to the word that says, I've arrived. There is not a person that doesn't come to the place of understanding that every day of my life, I am graced, even in the context of an ungraced world. And I want you to write this down. Write this down. Part of Imago Dei is, I get to live in the conscious awareness of my connection with Jesus Christ. He is every minute of the day engaged in my life. There is nothing that he already doesn't know, and in spite of that, still loves me. Because some of us live our life like, oh, well, you know what? I know he's the sovereign God of the universe, but I'm going to keep a secret. Really? Tell me how that's working for you. He knows. One of the most powerful moments in my life that shaped me was years ago in 1994. My grandfather, who came to Christ at age 60, after my father passed away, he had come to Christ and he made a decision as a businessman. He was an immigrant to this country, had a sixth grade education, and God just gave him favor. And he says, I'm going to be a missionary to Guatemala. And at age 60, this man became my hero, in which he just simply said, I'm going to do whatever it takes to serve Christ. And he didn't have a Bible college education. He just started serving. And then this man who I love so much came down with Alzheimer's. And for several years of my life, my brother and myself and other members of the family became a caregiver. And one of the most challenging things was to have this man who knew me not even know who I was. And we would go, and I would go for 24-hour periods, drive from all the way from San Jose to Mountain View, and the nurse would leave, and I would my grandfather would say to me, sir, you're such a nice man. You're such a nice man. And I'd say, thank you. And he would say funny things sometimes, like one day I was there caring for him, and he goes, sir, there are British rats in the corner of my room. And I said, well, why? How do you know they're British? He says, they have an accent. I said, okay. But you never argue with a person with Alzheimer's because it puts them in a catastrophic response, they call it. It sets them off. And I remember time was going on, I would tell my wife, I just want my grandfather one time to know who I am. It was a Saturday afternoon, and he used to love listening to the old Christian music, Bill Gaither and all that. And I was playing the music, and I was shaving his face. And he loved to have his face shaved. So as while I'm shaving his face, he looks up at me and he goes, sir, you're so kind. Thank you for shaving my face. And I said, Mr. Soto, you're welcome. And he says, this feels so good. Thank you for taking the time and shaving my face. I said, Mr. Soto, you don't need to thank me. It's my pleasure. And then all of a sudden, he does this. He's laying on his bed, and he grabs the back of my head, and he pulls me down, and he puts his hands on my face, and he looks at me in the eyes. And he says, Albert, that's you. I love you, Albert. I have my whole heart. I love you. And then he went back into the fog. I'm not going to ask you to read it, but in 2 Samuel chapter 9, David goes like this. Is there anybody in the household of David that's still alive? Is there anyone I could show kindness to? There's Mephibosheth. Go and get Mephibosheth. And when the men went over to the place where Mephibosheth was, he already thought they had come to kill him. He throws himself down and he says, here I am. He says, whatever the king would desire to do with my life, I've already surrendered it. They said, you don't need to worry about that. He wants to meet with you. He wants to meet with you. And they take Mephibosheth and they take him to David, to the palace. And David comes out and he's already surrendered himself. And what happens in the text is amazing. Because David looks at the face of Mephibosheth and he says, Mephibosheth, guess what? I loved your father, Jonathan, and I kept a covenant with him. This is now your house. This is your house. And you get to be here and live here. I'm sure that Mephibosheth must have just had so many things going through his mind. And here's what the writer, this is what Samuel says in the final verse. He says this, and it's so powerful and it's so wonderful. He says, and Mephibosheth sat at the table of the king, and he was lame. Why would the writer say that? Let me tell you why the writer would say that. When you sit at the king's table, it doesn't matter if you have a limp. When we read Ephesians chapter 2:10, that we are his masterpiece, it doesn't matter if you've had a history of abuse, addiction, abandonment, neglect. Maybe for some of us, we did things that we're still trying to wrestle with. This is the one thing that God says. He looks at us like he looked at Mephibosheth, and he says, you sit at my table. I am the master artist, and I have created you as a unique piece of work. And I've invited you to come to the table. And the power of that changes the history, because you're looking at that. My children have never seen their father drunk. My children have never seen me abuse alcohol. They have only known their father being sober. And then you get a call, and God says, guess what? You get to work with another generation. You get to work with kids. And not with some type of unhealthy kind of weird thing that some people get caught up with, that where I'm going to go fix a whole generation on my own. But that I just get to share my story, just like we get to do in the church. It's just a story that Jesus met me. And that here I am today, and my story engaged the story of God's, and that I get to be a living witness of sharing my life of redemption to other people. This is the reason why I tell people all the time, everywhere I go, I attract three types of people: addicts, intellectuals, and business people, and sometimes all three of them in one person. That's my story. My wife and I were just in a restaurant, and the gal comes up and she says, are you the Bayside pastor that's new in town? She said, yeah. She begins to tell me how she's battling alcoholism. And my wife goes, why does this happen to you all the time? The reason being is because you're looking at a redeemed alcoholic. I go in with an ear infection 3 weeks ago. The doctor's there blowing the wax out of my ear. I think I lost IQ. And then he's there blowing it out. And he looks at me and he goes, do you know Bill W.? I said, yeah. He says, I got 15 years. He says, if for some reason I feel like I need to tell you my story. And here's this doctor telling me about his sobriety, but he's trying to figure out who his higher power is. And I said, I'm going to tell you who my higher power is. His name is Jesus Christ. My wife goes, it happened again. Why is that? Because I'm a bug light. And you're a bug light. And we've been called to be the best bug lights we can be. We're bug lights. Our story becomes the attractive agent of what Jesus has done in our lives. And this is the reason why we just don't sit around telling people, well, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. And we think that's so powerful and awesome. Like it's humble. You know, I'm just a sinner saved by... No. You are a saint. You are a sinner who's saved, who is made a saint, who sometimes sins. In other words, you're a bug light. You kind of follow what I'm saying? And then God calls us. Write this down. And by the way, if you're trying to follow me at the slides, there's something wrong with my things here, so don't even follow me, and I'm going a different direction. I don't want to make you crazy. They're probably all going up there going. Write this down. You do not find your calling. You're formed for your calling. This whole thing in the church, what's your calling? What do you feel, Jesus? What's your gifts? I mean, I love gifts. What's your gifts? And somehow we make an occupational hazard by trying to go through this process that is so kind of, you know, you just find your calling. You just go and you try some things. And no. You're formed for your calling. When I was at the height of my alcoholism, God knew my story. And he says, I'm going to shape you and I'm going to change you. And I'm going to form you to be a bug light for me. And there are some of you that might be bug lights for people coming out of gangs or people that are dealing with different things. We're all bug lights, but we are formed as part of the journey for the calling that God has for us. So then crisis and negative things really aren't that bad because they're the things that shape us for a future that we haven't seen yet. Man, this is good stuff. And then he puts you in the greatest place on planet Earth. When we could take back our identity and know that all of us walk with a limp and that we sit at the king's table and that we are doing the best we can to invite other people to sit at the king's table as well. Then what happens is absolutely stupendous because it doesn't matter about title, position, hierarchy, or even all the gobbledygook that we make the church out to be. Gobbledygook in the Hebrew means gobbledygook. Because we get into all this weird stuff with the church. Man, I love it. I have a friend of mine who's 53 years old who's still a children's pastor. And he's a good one. And I never heard him once come up and say, I want to be a lead pastor now. I want to get promoted. Really? Now all of a sudden we got HR in heaven going on. God's just a big HR resource center. And we're all going to get promoted. Listen, where your calling takes you is the highest place you'll ever be. Where your calling takes you and where He places you is the highest place you'll ever be. Now, that's not to say some people don't become lead pastors. But you know what? Being a lead pastor or anything else in the body of Christ is not based on a good idea. It's based on a God idea. And it's based on our story and who God has called us to be. You're already promoted. You're His masterpiece. I'm going to finish up with this story. What I'm going to tell you tonight has shaped how I do ministry. It shapes everything that I do. We were pastoring in San Jose. We had a church that was between a poodle wash and a sandwich shop. Figure that one out. One Sunday morning, we're doing communion, and I'm up in front of the church. We had four services. We had a place that wasn't much bigger than this. And I'm getting up there in communion, and I say, God, speak to us. The poodle wash wasn't supposed to be open on Sunday. All of a sudden, the dog goes, and everyone starts losing it. Because I said, now God's a terrier. We had that kind of a situation. Our facilities were not fancy, but man, people were finding Christ. And one family came, and they came out of a broken past. They were a blended family, and they had a son, and his name was Eddie. Eddie had Down syndrome. He was the sweetest young man. He would come up every Sunday after service, and he'd say, Pastor Al, I want to receive Jesus into my heart. And I'd pray with Eddie. One day during a staff meeting, the staff said, hey, you know, Pastor Al, Eddie comes up every Sunday, and he asks to receive Christ. When are you going to tell him he doesn't need to do that anymore? I said, when I build a relationship with Eddie. And we have a relationship where he knows me and we have trust. And so one day Eddie comes up and he says, Pastor Al, will you pray for me? I really want Jesus to really be in my heart. I said, Eddie, you already know Jesus. You know that. Oh, yeah, Pastor Al. This is a young man who had his little book that he'd bring with him, and he journaled every day a verse of Scripture. His mom would help him. He journaled every day a verse of Scripture. I said, you already know Jesus. This is what I want you to do. I want you to go home with your mom and your dad, pray, and ask the Lord where He would want you to serve. And then I'm going to call you this week, and we're going to meet and get a soda, and then you can tell me. Okay, Pastor Al, what staff meeting? It was a lot of fun. Because I tell him what happened that Sunday, because we'd always share our stories for the week. And I said, here's what I did. And they said, Pastor Al, what happens if Eddie comes back and tells you he wants to be the worship leader? What are you going to do then? Literally, they're going there, man. I was like right in the middle of the Sanhedrin. They weren't the staff anymore. They were Sanhedrin. I said, you guys are Sanhedrin, man. So I said this to them. I said, listen, do you believe that we're all created in the image of Christ? Yes. Do you believe that every man, woman, and child is created in the image of God? Yes. Do you believe the same Spirit that drew us to that understanding is the same Spirit that could speak to Eddie? Well, if you put it that way. I said, let's trust the Spirit of God. I had the soda with Eddie, and he had a big smile on his face. He goes, Pastor Al, do you know what I want to be and how I want to serve? And I go, what's that? I want to be a greeter. For 3 years, Eddie didn't miss a Sunday. Rain or shine, he'd be out greeting people. And when people would be coming into the, and not just one service, every service he would stay. And he would tell people, I just love this church, and you're going to love it too. He'd tell people, I found love here. I want you to come and find the same love that I have found. Every Sunday. One Saturday, I'm driving back home from an event. And my wife says, honey, you need to get to Good Samaritan Hospital. Eddie is really sick. And I remember driving to Good Sam, and I'm going, God, what's going on? And I walk into the intensive care unit, and the nurse attended our church. And she said, Al, I'm not supposed to tell you this, but Eddie's probably not going to make it tonight. He has severe staph infection pneumonia in his lungs. And anything about people who have Down syndrome, later on when they're in later adolescence, their lungs won't develop, and this was a common thing. I didn't know what to do or what to say when she was telling me that, but the next few moments changed my life. I walked into the room. Eddie's on the bed. His family's around. And I walk up, and Eddie just takes his hand, his little feeble hand. He goes, Pastor Al, is that you? Yeah, Eddie. He goes, Pastor Al, don't be sad. He says, tonight I might see Jesus, and I'm okay. I love Jesus. And I go, okay, Eddie. And he says, Pastor Al, you know what I'm going to do? I go, what's that, Eddie? When I get to heaven, I'm going to be a greeter. I'm going to be a greeter so that when you get to the other side, I'm going to be there and I'm going to greet you. And at that moment, the only thing I can ask myself, who really had the handicap? You know, we talk about we talk about the good news, but sometimes I just wonder how much of it do we really understand really is good news. It's good news for everybody. See, for some of us, we got a limp, and we've been walking with this limp, and we've been walking around Jesus, but we're not letting Jesus confront us. We're working with kids, but there's a part of our heart we're really not going to let anyone get to, because it's off limits. God, you don't know what I've dealt with. And then the committee in our head just constantly says, you're not worthy, you're not this. And it's almost like we're living this dual life. And what Eddie taught me was the simplicity that Jesus speaks and he forms us for a call. He forms everybody for a call, and he has a purpose, and he distinctly calls us with an identity of being his masterpiece. And there is nothing, because the writer Paul says it this way, there is nothing that can keep us from that kind of love. And all he wants us to do is surrender and say, Jesus, you can have it. You can have it. I walk with a limp, but I sit at the table of the King. And that's where I can be the best bug light. That's where my story really matters. Because the focus isn't on what's broke. The focus is on what Jesus is up to. We need a generation of kids that have children directors who have that kind of focus on their identity, that they reproduce that in the life of kids. I believe that we live in a day and age that we need a generation of kids that will rise up and not wait till they have to go and be battered and bruised, but they can live for Christ and they can do great things for God now, not when they become adults, but now. But if we're going to do that, it's going to take you and I and other workers to get a hold of an identity that says we are his masterpiece and that God is using us now with the story that he's given us. And that we walk with a limp, but we're at the highest place where he's called us to invite other people to come to the table of the King. So I'm going to ask that you do this. This is going to be an evening of trust. Maybe for some of us, we haven't done this in a while. But the team is here, and I'm going to ask that wherever you're at, if you've been walking with a limp, if there's something that's just been right there that you've been kind of identifying with, that's been keeping you from your full identity, I'm just going to ask that you just come up and just stand up here. We're going to pray for you. That you just come up and just say, here I am. Now, this is the first night, and you've probably traveled, and you're tired, and I get it. But why this kind of a call? because you're going to hear a lot of good stuff this week. But I felt on my heart as I was praying. You want to know something? Jesus, I know there are people that are still wrestling and still battling and still struggling with stuff. Unworth, unloved, not good enough. I need to perform and earn it. And Jesus simply wants to invite you to come so that he can just say, you're my masterpiece. Jesus, thank you for your spirit. Thank you for what you're up to. And I ask that by your spirit, those areas that are broken in our lives that we've identified with, the areas of shame, the areas of blame, we call out addiction. We call out abuse. We call out a neglect. We call out abandonment. We call out all those things and say that they are weak in the presence of Christ. And that Jesus, you would have your way by your spirit. And I'm just going to ask right where you're at, can you just stand? If that's you and you got brokenness and you got stuff, that you just stand. Go ahead. Just stand. Just stand right where you're at. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And Jesus, for these men and women who are standing tonight in Jesus' name, I pray that by your Spirit you begin to take the places of their heart and that you begin to uproot and that you begin to do a work that only you could do, that, Lord, shame would no longer rule. The lies of an adversary whispering in their ear would no longer muffle out the voice of a Savior that says, you are my beloved. I've called you. I've created you. I've given you divine purpose. Lord, we would pray that fear would be put down. Shame would be put down. That shame that would take the truth and distort it and twist it and somehow say that I'm less than what God intended. That, Lord, you would have your way and that by your Spirit, they would never be the same after tonight. That by your Spirit, they would fully surrender to that place that where you have placed them is to be the masterpiece that they were created. And that you're the master artist. That, Lord, there are women who are standing that they would know that they are daughters of Father God and that they could sit at his feet. Fully engaged as a daughter, that these men who are standing would know that as sons, they are a son of the Most High God, that they've been given your stamp of approval, that you have placed your fingerprint on the very depths of their soul, and then in Jesus' name, you would do your work and you would have your way. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.